England,
One great French writer in the 18th and 19th centuries didn't have time to write his books. The author was Nicolas Edme Retif de Le Breton. And his unique literary trick was to simply transfer his stories direct from his brain to the printing press. He created 152 books this way. A man who could literally think in cold type. Believe it or not.
The boss came into Paddy, he said, there's a phone call for you. And he picked up the phone and said, oh, that's terrible. Ah, that's awful sad. The boss said to him, he said, bad news? He says, yes, my father has just died. And 2 minutes later, he was putting his coat on. There was another phone call. And he said, oh, that's even worse. That's shocking. And he put the phone down. The foreman said, was that more bad news? Oh, yeah, that was my brother. His father has died as well.
This is Radio England, UK.
The truth. The whole truth. Nothing but the truth. The hidden truth. The vital human drama of the famous lie detector. Bringing you authentic case histories from the files of the late Leonard Keeler, one of the world's foremost scientific criminologists. Mr. Keeler's real-life part is played by Hart McGuire, who reveals from week to week some of the most baffling human dramas of our times. The Hidden Truth. Incredible history of the lie detector, I can't remember a more incredible series of events than those which shaped the human drama about to unfold this evening. About 3 o'clock one cold and blustery winter's morning, Mrs. Alex Graham cried out in her sleep.
Oh, I can't stand it. Alex, wake up, please.
There was no answer to Mrs. Graham's outcry.
Alex! Oh, what's the use? I'd better phone myself. Operator, get me a doctor, please. I'm in terrible pain. What? Oh, any doctor. Oh, 1214 Avenue A. Hurry. Oh, hurry, please.
Hello in there.
Hey, what do you think you're doing?
Glad to see you, officer. Maybe you better look into this.
Yeah? First, I think I better look into you. What are you doing out here, pounding on doors this time of the morning?
Excuse me, I can understand how I might look suspicious.
Very suspicious. What's your name?
Dr. Mills. I'm an intern on the staff at Memorial Hospital.
Yeah? Live in this neighborhood?
No, the phone company called in and said someone in this house wanted a doctor in a hurry. I tried the bell a half dozen times, and I've been pounding on the door. Maybe we'd better break in.
Now, wait a minute. You got proof you're a doctor?
Yeah, shine your flashlight on this.
Looks okay. But I can't break down any doors without a court order.
Look, officer, someone in this house is sick or they wouldn't call a doctor. Do you think this is any time to worry about legal red tape?
Well, if it's all the same to you, I'd rather wait for the sergeant to come around. If he says it's okay...
How soon will he be around?
He makes the rounds about every hour. Let's see, he drove through this neighborhood about 35 minutes ago. That means he ought to be...
You think I'm going to stand here and wait 25 minutes when someone might be dying in there?
What about my job? If I make a decision like this and the sergeant don't like it, I'm liable to get shipped to the sticks somewhere.
Well, let's assume that you didn't make the decision. I did. Come on, let's try to crack this door.
Wait. I don't like this one bit. I'd better walk down to the call box and phone the station.
Then please hurry. I'll keep knocking on the door and see if I can rouse anyone.
Oh, I didn't think I'd ever be able to get downstairs.
Hey, what's the trouble here, lady?
Never mind, I'll handle this. Here, I'd better help you over to that sofer. Give me a hand, officer.
I tried to get my husband up, but nothing ever wakens him.
Must be an early sleeper to stay in bed through all this racket.
Here, now lie down here, please.
I've never had such a sharp pain in my life. Oh, it's almost like a knife.
Where is the pain?
In my side. Right here.
A little pressure here.
No, don't!
Oh, officer.
Yeah, what is it? Something she ate?
I'm going to wrap my coat around her and get her down to the hospital in my car. I don't want to take the time to wait for an ambulance.
Is it that bad?
Oh. After you help us out to the car, come back and phone Memorial Hospital. Tell them to put in a call for Dr. Warren.
Warren?
Yes, chief surgeon on the staff. Tell him to get the operating room ready for an emergency appendectomy. Then try to get a husband up and tell him what's happened. I hope I got a hearing time, Dr. Warren.
Mills, I don't like the looks of this.
Is something wrong?
No inflammation whatsoever. Perfectly normal appendix.
What? But there was a resistance, and I'd be willing to swear that...
I know. Looked like an emergency case to me, too.
It's a severe pain in that region. What would any doctor think?
Nurse!
Dr. Warren, she stopped breathing. She's...
Oxygen! Oxygen at once! Mills, I don't know what to say about this. We made a bad error in diagnosis.
Well, we thought we were doing our best for her. No one can deny that.
I'll make out the report. Emergency appendectomy. Patient succumbed under anesthesia.
I'd give a lot to know what really did cause that severe pain, Dr. Warren.
Yes, so would I. I'm going to ask your husband's permission to probe further and make some laboratory tests. Anything we can track down might prevent a repetition of this unfortunate business.
Hey, Dr. Mills, I hear things didn't go so good for the Graham woman.
Things didn't, officer. Did you bring your husband with you?
Look, doctor, when we first went in her house, she did mention her husband, didn't she?
She did. She said she tried to get her husband up, but nothing ever awakens him.
You sure of that, huh?
Certainly.
I went through that house from basement to attic, and no husband.
What? But she mentioned a husband, officer. He must have been in the house.
If he was, he didn't do any sleeping there last night. The only bed mussed up was the one she was sleeping in, and that was a single. There was another twin bed in the room with the covers turned down. I guess it was ready for someone who never came home because it had fresh sheets on it that weren't even mussed.
Mills, you suppose she thought her husband was there when he actually wasn't?
It's possible in her severe pain that she didn't realize that he hadn't come home.
Yes, it is possible. See here, officer. It's very important that we find her husband without any further delay. I'd appreciate it if you will check with some of the Graham neighbors and see if they can give you any information about him.
What, 4:45 in the morning?
I think it's very important that you should try to locate him, officer, without any further delay.
Okay. I'll go back to my beat, and when the sergeant comes around, I'll ask.
Good Lord, we've been all over the sergeant business before. Can't you do anything on your own initiative?
Sure I can. Providing the sergeant okays it.
Well, will you please get back to us as soon as possible with any information you can pick up? If you can't find a husband, find a next of kin. We've got to notify one of her relatives.
Right. If the sergeant okays my making an investigation, I'll report back to him and have him call the lieutenant.
The lieutenant?
Sure. All my reports clear through the sergeant, and he clears them through the lieutenant. That way, everything gets done faster, see?
No, I don't see.
Oh, never mind. World's full of red tape, Mills. Go on. We'll have to make a full report on this. I want a description of the operation right up to the point of death.
I want to look at that incision you made. Again, Dr. Warren, I want to satisfy myself that there is absolutely no inflammation of that appendix.
I think you'll prove that to yourself quickly enough.
Well, I'd be willing to bet that 99 out of 100 doctors in a similar situation and with similar symptoms would diagnose it as acute appendicitis.
Yes, but on the other hand, too many of us blame the appendix for all sorts of abdominal pains. I, for one, won't be caught again, I assure you.
Well, I sure wish they'd send someone else out in this case beside me.
Well, that's part of your internship, my boy. You'll have to learn to take all cases as they come, do your very best with each one of them. With your medical training and a great deal of care and diagnosis, your margin of success will be much greater than your margin of error. That's all they can ask of any doctor.
You're being very kind about this, and I appreciate it, Dr. Warren.
Oh. Don't forget, I'm not an intern, and I made the same mistake. Here, let's examine that incision. I'll show you just how wrong... By George Mills!
Dr. Warren, that incision! Someone's been here!
Someone's been here is right. The entire inner stomach has been removed. Nurse! Nurse, come in here.
What is it, Dr. Warren?
Who's been in this room?
Why, no one, Dr. Warren. Except her husband came in to identify the body.
Her husband?
Why, yes. Didn't you know he was here, Dr. Mills? He said he had your permission.
Her husband? Well, I'll
handle this, Mills. That's all, Miss Bates. Thank you.
Yes, Dr. Warren.
Oh, wait a minute.
Yes?
Call the district attorney's office. Ask him if he can get over here as quickly as possible.
It's pretty early in the morning, Dr. Warren. Only a little after 5.
I know, but I think they'd better get him up.
All right. Is it something about Mrs. Graham or her husband?
If you don't mind, I'll save that for the district attorney, Miss Bates.
Oh, yes, Doctor.
Dr. Warren, I swear I never saw her husband. I haven't talked to anyone about this case except you and that police officer and Mrs. Graham herself.
Whoever removed that stomach did a very professional job, Mills.
But I'm no surgeon. Surely you don't think that I... Wait. What about...
Oh, of course. I'm a surgeon, am I not? Do you have the audacity to insinuate that I...
You came back in here. You were all alone for 10 minutes after she died. You had all the time in the world to...
You've said enough. I might mention that you, too, spent some time here alone, Mills. You came in to pick up the charts and stayed rather longer than necessary.
I am not a surgeon, Dr. Warren. And you yourself expressed the opinion that this is a very professional job.
Oh, look here, Mills. We're acting like children over this thing. We've allowed ourselves to be upset by the knowledge that there'll be an investigation made. We'll both be under suspicion, it's true, but if Miss Bates allowed Mrs. Graham's husband to come in here...
Suppose the husband turns out to know nothing about surgery.
Then we'll have to do some thorough investigating here at the hospital.
They'll think one of us tried to cover our mistake.
Oh, I'm not so sure. But in view of what's happened, I'm quite sure I know what caused her pain, Mills.
So am I. Poison.
Of course, poison. And whoever poisoned her didn't want it to be found in her stomach. The evidence has been removed.
Then it's obvious that her husband knew she was poisoned.
It seems even more obvious that he poisoned her. But we'll let the police make those kind of deductions. All we can say is that her husband was in this room alone, and that her stomach was removed by means of expert surgery.
He probably thought we'd never discover it.
That's why we've got to keep this discovery very quiet. If he doesn't suspect that we know, it'll be much easier for the police to contact him.
Well, gentlemen, we got it all straightened out. The neighbors knew all about Mrs. Graham.
Well, close that door, officer. We don't want to disturb the other patients.
It didn't take the sergeant and me long to find out that she hasn't got a husband.
What? This thing's gone far enough, officer. You heard her mention her husband and so did I.
Yes, and her husband actually came to this hospital tonight.
What are you trying to give me? How could he come here? Alex Graham's been dead for 5 years.
Dead? Are you sure?
Sure, I'm sure. I even found a half dozen neighbors who went to his funeral. He died suddenly in his sleep one night and made his wife go wacky. She tells everybody he isn't really dead, but just a heavy sleeper. Can you imagine that? When all her neighbors saw them put him in his grave.
But a man who claimed to be her husband came here tonight.
Yeah. Was he wearing a shroud and carrying a horse?
This is anything but funny, officer. Better call your sergeant and have the sergeant call a lieutenant and tell him to call out the whole police force. Death of Mrs. Graham looks like the most brazen kind of murder.
The
cast of characters in tonight's real-life drama of The Lie Detector includes Mrs. Alec Graham, who is rushed to Memorial Hospital by Dr. Mills, a young intern. Dr. Warren, head surgeon at the hospital, who officiated at the operating table upon which Mrs. Graham died. A nurse who witnessed the operation. Police officer Elrath, who assisted Dr. Mills, and a stranger who called at the hospital posing as Mrs. Graham's husband. The plot, of course, involves the disappearance of the dead woman's inner stomach, apparently removed by expert surgery. The next figure to enter this drama is District Attorney Charles Allison, whose immediate problem is to identify the principal unknown factor in the case. The man admitted to the dead woman's room by the nurse on duty at the time, Eleanor Bates.
Tell me, Miss Bates, when did you first see this man?
He got off the elevator on the operating floor and came right to my desk, Mr. Allison. He was terribly distraught and seemed as though he'd been drugged.
Drugged?
Then I realized that it was something else. He seemed half asleep.
Wait
I had trouble
minute,
understanding.
Miss Bates. This man told you that an officer told him his wife was here?
Yes.
Officer Elrath, is that true? Did you see her husband?
I did not. You know she hasn't got a husband. You saw the death record. He died 5 years ago.
Did you see anyone who claimed to be her husband? Did you tell anyone that Mrs. Graham was at this hospital?
I didn't see anyone. I didn't tell anyone. Except the sergeant. I went through that house and found one bed that was slept in and another one turned down like someone was expected. But it hadn't been slept in. Now the neighbors told me that...
I know. She refused to believe her husband had died and every night turned his bed down for him just as though he'd actually come and sleep in it.
Yeah, the woman was nuts.
She might have been nuts, but when her husband died, he left her $100,000 worth of insurance. We can't find any record that she spent very much of it. What's happened to that money?
Cat me. I didn't see it around the house, if that's what you mean.
If she was crazy enough to think her husband is still alive, she might be crazy enough to hide it somewhere instead of putting it in a bank. If someone found out about that money...
Sure. It'd be a simple matter to poison her, and after they cut it her away, all he'd have to do is pick up the dough.
Might have been slow poison. Whoever did it probably didn't reckon with her being taken to a hospital. He was afraid they'd discover the poison here and took a very bold method of lifting the evidence. Elrath?
Yes, sir?
I want you to join my men at the Graham home. I want to be sure that nothing's been disturbed since you checked over the place last night.
Okay. I just hope I don't find somebody laying in that empty bed, that's all.
Hello, an outside wire, please. Beg your pardon? Oh, this is Charles Allison. I'd like my office, if you please. Yes, I'll wait.
The man was terribly shocked when I told him Mrs. Graham was dead. He couldn't seem to believe it and insisted on seeing the body. I took him as far as the door.
Hello? Allison. Looks like poison and possible robbery, Fred. But if it's poison, it's been removed, stomach and all. If it's robbery, we don't know what and how much. I'm going to play a hunch, Fred. I want you to go back 5 years and get out the records on Alec Graham, deceased. He left about $100,000 worth of insurance, and I'm going to have his body exhumed.
Two days later, District Attorney Charles Allison sat in my office. He was a very puzzled man.
Honestly, Keeler, if your lie detector can't unravel this mess, I'm not sure that anything can.
Yeah, now let me see. 4 known suspects, 1 unknown.
Yes. 2 of them with obvious motives, 1 with a hypothetical motive.
As I understand it, Dr. Warren might have tampered with the body in order to take attention away from the fact that he shouldn't have operated in the first place.
Yes, and that intern Mills might have committed some blunder, such as giving her the wrong medicine and he's trying to cover.
It was the man who posed as her husband. Why are you coming on that?
The nurse gave us a complete description, but so far we haven't gotten anywhere in tracking him down. We made a pretty thorough search of the Graham home, too. No evidence of poison, no evidence of robbery, not much evidence of any kind. Except that we're quite certain no man lived in that house.
About her husband's body, you were going to have that exhumed, I understand.
Yes.
Well, suppose you find evidence of murder in the death of Alec Graham. That would take the case back 5 years. Excuse me. Yes, Keeler. Oh, yes, he's here. For you, Allison.
Thanks.
Hello?
What? Well, that's incredible. Are you absolutely sure? Well, I'm going right out there. I've got to see that for myself.
Like a break for you, Allison?
Keeley, there's no body in that grave.
Is what?
They just finished opening that grave a few minutes ago, and the body is gone, coffin and all.
While Charles Allison concentrated on the search for the missing body of Alec Graham and the mysterious person who posed as Alec Graham, I went about the business of running polygraph deception tests on the known personalities in the case. Now, your name is Edgar Warren.
It is.
Just answer yes or no, please.
Well, that's an interesting machine, Mr. Keeler. Blood pressure curve, pulse rate, respiratory curve, and measurement of skin resistance, hmm?
Yes, I'm glad you're familiar with this operation. Actually, the more you know about the polygraph, the more difficult it is to beat.
Oh, I see.
Shall we continue?
Yes, by all means.
Is your name Edgar Warren?
Yes.
Dr. Edgar Warren?
Yes.
Do you live in this city?
Yes.
Have you had something to eat today?
Yes.
Did you perform an appendectomy on Mrs. Alec Graham?
I started to, but she succumbed on the table.
Just yes or no, please. Dr. Warren, did you remove Mrs. Graham's stomach?
No.
You're quite sure you've eaten today?
Yes.
You're sure you didn't remove that stomach in order to take attention away from your misdiagnosis?
What the devil are you getting at, man? I'm head surgeon at this hospital. Are you questioning my integrity?
You know about that operation, Dr. Warren. You're covering up for someone. Now, Dr. Mills, any discussion will only delay the test. Please answer my questions with either a yes or a no. Understand?
I understand. Go ahead.
Is your name Thomas Mills?
Yes.
Dr. Thomas Mills?
Yes.
Do you live in this city?
Yes.
Have you had something to eat today?
Yes.
Did you know Mrs. Alec Graham?
Yes.
Did you perform any sort of an operation on Mrs. Graham?
No, I didn't.
Did you give Mrs. Graham any medicine?
Yes.
Did you make a mistake in what you gave her?
No.
Dr. Mills, did you give your patient a lethal dose of poison by mistake?
No, I did not. I had nothing to do with it. Absolutely nothing.
Now, Miss Bates, you understand the procedure.
Yes, I understand, Mr. Keeler.
Mm-hmm. Is your name Eleanor Bates?
Yes.
You're a registered nurse?
Yes.
You've had considerable experience with operating techniques, haven't you?
No.
Have you eaten today?
Yes.
You've had quite a bit of experience in operating techniques, haven't you, Miss Bates?
I have not.
Yes? Do you want to continue the test, or do you think we can talk without the polygraph?
Turn it off. Please turn it off.
I hope you're sure of what you're doing, Sheila.
We'll soon know, Allison. We'll soon know.
Suppose his body is buried down here in the basement of his own home. How did it get here?
Well, I hope to answer that question as soon as Elrath gets back.
All right, hold it.
All right, George Keeler, there is a coffin down here.
But don't tell me Mrs. Graham buried it here herself.
Well, here's your full report, Allison. Number one, Dr. Warren.
Anything on him?
No, except that he knows who performed that extracurricular operation. He was trying to protect a member of his staff. He suspected this person, wanted to handle it in his own way.
Dr. Mills?
No. According to his polygram, Dr. Mills is a very serious young intern who seems to have good judgment and has every intention of becoming a top-flight physician.
And what member of the staff had reason
to... Eleanor Bates.
What? The nurse?
Yes. It was she who removed that stomach and gave it to the man who called at the hospital that night.
But why? What's the incentive for a thing like that?
$5,000.
Huh?
The man who came to the hospital that night was Henry Sellers, an undertaker in this city.
An undertaker?
Yes. He was the undertaker who originally buried Alec Graham. During the embalming, he noticed traces of arsenic and went to Mrs. Graham with his accusation.
You know? You found out?
Yes, I know, Mrs. Graham. You poisoned your husband for his insurance, didn't you?
If you'll bury him without disclosing what you found, I'll pay you $5,000, Mr. Sellers.
$10,000.
All right, $10,000.
As months went by, Mrs. Graham began to have hallucinations about her husband. Her mind gave way gradually. She wanted her husband close to her.
If you were to bribe the gravediggers late at night and bring my husband's body to my house,
That'll be very expensive, Mrs. Graham. If anyone should find out and become suspicious that your husband's death was not caused by a heart attack...
I'm prepared to pay, Mr. Sellers. I'm prepared to pay.
But the death of Mrs. Graham, Keeler. Sellers grew increasingly more greedy. He knew that Mrs. Graham had a small fortune hidden somewhere. And if he could get her out of the way... Oh. Alrath, bring him in.
If only she died at home where she was supposed to die, you never would have found out. You never would have suspected.
Where's that money, Sellers? What did you do with Mrs. Graham's money?
You find it buried. In the cemetery.
Keeler, I'm becoming more and more convinced if every potential criminal knew he'd have to reckon with the lie detector, I don't think there'd be many criminals left in the world, potential or any other kind.
Hidden Truth stars Hart McGuire as Leonard Keeler, dramatizing actual case histories.
Featured with him in tonight's presentation, you heard the following artists. Mrs. Graham, Moya O'Sullivan. Mills, Mark Kelly. Cop, Ed Heppel. Warren, John Bushell. Nurse, Dinah Shearing. Allison, Wayne Paulsing. Sellers, John Llewellyn.
Be with us again for The Hidden Truth, a Columbia Hilda Skirr production.
Radio England, you play 1111.
It probably didn't matter whether the old fellow was a good ruler or not. The issue was that he seemed to be on the verge of ruling forever. He was King Alangsithu of ancient Burma, who ruled from 1075 to 1160, a remarkably long reign of 85 years. King Alangsithu would have ruled even longer, but he was murdered by his own son, Narothu, who was afraid his father would rule forever, believe it or not.
M-A-R-A-T-H-O-N.
Peanuts and caramel.
Marathon.
Peanuts and liver.
Marathon.
Peanuts and chocolate.
Comes with peanuts. It smells like the sun. Marathon.
Roasted peanuts.
Extra peanut taste.
Comes up peanuts. Slice after slice.
Marathon.
Radio England, UK 11111.
From New York City, the makers of Clipper Craft clothes for men and 1036 leading retail stores from coast to coast present the world's most famous detective, Sherlock Holmes. Tonight's story, The Adventure of the Empty House. Well, here we are as usual in Dr. Watson's hospitable study, all ready and waiting for our weekly treat. What's it to be tonight, Dr. Watson?
Well, tonight I think I'll tell you how Holmes made an unexpected and, I may say, dramatic return after many years' absence. Yes, it was so dramatic I came dashed close to fainting.
Well, well.
But before we go into that, suppose you tell us about a happy surprise that's in store for the chaps who buy their first Clippercroft clothes. Surprise that won't shock their pocketbooks.
How right you are, Dr. Watson. New spring Clippercraft clothes are arriving constantly at fine stores everywhere. That's an important announcement for men who have always worn Clippercraft, and for those who will wear them for the first time this spring, because Clippercraft values are even more sensational today than ever before. And that's saying plenty. The Clippercraft plan concentrates the buying power of 1,036 of the nation's finest stores from coast to coast, making possible steady year-round operation, resulting in tremendous savings in manufacturing and distribution costs, and putting those savings, even in the face of today's high prices, where they belong, in your pocket. And don't forget that your Clippercraft dealer is a friendly local independent store, a store you can trust. Handsome new Clippercraft suits are only $40 and $45. Top coats and fine coverts and worsted gabardine are only $40 and $45. Sport jackets, but $26.50. And superb tropicals, but $33.75 to $40. Compare Clippercraft with clothes selling for many dollars more. And now, Dr. Watson, to get back to Mr. Holmes' dramatic reappearance.
Right. You know, I've always said it's a good thing to absent yourself from time to time. Makes people appreciate you when you come back. That's what Holmes said the time he was missing for 3 years.
3 years? That's a pretty long lapse of time.
Yes, it was, rather. Everyone thought he was dead. What a horrible time that was. I couldn't bear to live in our old lodgings in Baker Street. Associations and everything.
Yes.
It's funny how sentimental we all are underneath. I'd taken up my quarters in a more fashionable part of town and resumed my medical practice. It was after Holmes had succeeded in driving Professor Moriarty out of England. We all believed Holmes had sacrificed his life to rid society of that evil spirit.
That sounds terrifically exciting, Doctor. Won't you tell us how Holmes managed to put a finish to Moriarty?
What? Kill off Professor Moriarty before I've told you the rest of our adventures with him? Well, I should say not. Never catch me throwing away good material, but let's get down to cases.
Fair enough.
Very well. It was in the spring of the year 1894 when all of London, the fashionable world in particular, was dismayed by the death under most unusual circumstances of the Honorable Ronald Adair. That likable young gentleman was the second son of the Earl of Maynooth. He lived, together with his mother, the Countess of Maynooth, and his sister Hilda, at 427 Park Lane. The youth moved in the best society, but was very fond of cards, played continually.
Aha, piling up gambling debts he couldn't pay.
Well, as a matter of fact, it came out in evidence that he had actually won as much as £420 in one sitting at his club the week previous, from Godfrey Miller and Lord Balmoral, I believe it was. His partner was a certain Colonel Moran.
But then he must have been well ahead of the game.
Oh, quite. And yet it was to this easygoing, likable, I might even say lucky young aristocrat, that death came in a most strange and unexpected form on the night of the March the 30th. He returned from his club shortly after 10, his mother and sister having gone to the opera. The butler, Peter, swore that he heard him enter the front room on the second floor, generally used as his sitting room. The night being chilly, he had lit a fire, and as it showed a tendency to smoke, one of the front windows had been opened about 4 inches. Nothing further was heard from this sitting room until 11:30, the hour of the return of Lady Maynooth and her daughter. Peters testified that her ladyship seemed rather agitated.
Hilda, I declare I'm chilled to the bone.
I'm sorry, Mama.
Oh, Peters, will you help me with my carriage boots?
Certainly, milady. You've returned so early. I trust the opera was not a disappointment.
Oh, no, indeed, Peters. It was heavenly. Only Mama can never bear to stay for the death scenes at the end.
So depressing, I always think.
Why, Mama, I've always thought Carmen was terribly gay. Just because he knifes in the last scene doesn't
mean... No, I know. But so primitive, so brutal. And that bit in the gypsy camp. Well, Carmen keeps turning up the ace of spades, the card of death. I had the queerest foreboding during that scene, as though Ronnie needed me. Oh, dear, I do wish he wouldn't play whist so often. I'm sure it's not good for him. A boy his age should have other interests. I wish I could get that ace of spades out of my mind. I can't help feeling it means something.
Oh, nonsense, Mama. You've just given yourself another case of the fidgets. It's the English climate that's depressing you, that's all. One day of sunshine and you'll be as gay as a lark.
I'm sure I hope so. Oh, dear, listen to that wind. Fog and rain, rain and fog. Peters, has Mr. Bonnell come in yet?
Yes, my lady, over an hour ago. He's upstairs in his sitting room.
Well, thank heaven for that. I think I'll just go up and say goodnight to him.
That's right, Mama. Make sure he isn't sitting in a draught.
Hilda, really? I declare I don't know what children are coming to nowadays. No respect for their parents.
Good night, darling.
And you're not to sit up till all hours, mind?
No, Mama.
Really, I don't know how young girls nowadays expect to keep their looks if they never go to bed. Oh, dear, that wind. It's so eerie. Ronnie, dear, it's Mother. Why, it's locked. The door's locked. Ronnie, are you all right? Ronnie!
Mother, what's the matter?
Ronnie, he's locked himself in. He doesn't answer. Peters, Hilda. Oh, come quickly, I'm afraid.
Mother.
Oh, Ronnie, why don't you answer?
No, don't worry, my lady.
It's all right, Mother, he's probably fallen asleep.
Ronnie, oh, Hilda, I'm frightened. Peters, can't you break the door down?
I can try, my lady.
Here, let me help. Now then, both together.
There, my lady. I've fallen asleep at the desk.
But he looked so strange. Cards scattered everywhere, and look there. The ace of spades. There's blood on it. Blood dripping onto the carpet. Ronnie!
Oh! Peters, quick, help me, she's fainted.
Oh, dear.
Here, put her on the couch.
No, poor Lady Maynooth.
Oh, dear, Mother.
Shall I call the doctor, miss?
Oh, never mind, Mother, it's Ronnie we have to worry about. Maybe it's not too late. Oh, Ronnie. Oh, his head. How horrible.
Shot with a soft bullet. Better not look, miss. It's not nice.
Oh, Ronnie, darling, why did you do it?
He didn't, miss.
Oh, but Peters, he must have. The door was locked on the inside.
It's not suicide, Miss Hilda. It's murder. Mr. Ronnie couldn't have done it. There's no weapon anywhere in the room.
Look here, Dr. Watson. Ronald Adair was in the second-story sitting room with the door locked on the inside.
Exactly, Mr. Harris. Furthermore, he was in the room alone.
Yes, but if someone else shot him, how is that possible?
That's what puzzled the authorities. No one could have climbed up to the open window without leaving traces of some sort. The outside wall was perfectly smooth, no ivy, no water pipes. Furthermore, there was a drop of over 20 feet from the window to the ground.
Well, then the murderer couldn't have been in the room with young Adair. He must have shot at him from the street below.
Remember, the window was open only 4 inches and the glass was not shattered.
That would be a pretty remarkable shot, Doctor.
Furthermore, Park Lane is not an unfrequented thoroughfare, and there is a cab stand within 50 yards of the house, and yet no one heard a shot.
Nice little problem.
Yes, exactly. Scotland Yard was at its wit's end. Our old friend, Inspector Lestrade, even went so far as to consult me in the matter, knowing how familiar I was with Holmes' methods of deduction. And so I promised to have a look at the facade of Lady Maynooth's house in Park Lane to see if anything suggested itself to me.
And did it?
Now, Mr. Harris, you're anticipating again.
I'm sorry.
Well, so it was. But around 6 o'clock that evening, I found myself at the Oxford Street end of Park Lane. A heterogeneous collection of loafers on the pavement, all staring up at a particular window, directed me to the house I had come to see. Good evening, Constable.
Good evening, Dr. Watson, sir. I was told you might be dropping around for a look at the scene of crime.
Yes, nice little crowd you've collected here.
Yes, sir. Nothing like a good murder to bring him out of their house. And look at that old codger up there with the white whiskers. Pushed his way up to the front. But he ain't been out of doors for months. Looks fair dusty, he does.
Oh, you mean the bibliophile?
The what, sir?
Book lover.
Oh.
Notice the titles of the volumes under his arm. Say, let's have a look. Origin of Tree Worship. Sign Language of the Druids. Life in Early Crete. Evidently collects obscure volumes, either as a trade or a hobby.
Well, well, I never would have noticed. I'll hand it to you, Dr. Watson. You're almost as good with your deductions as Mr. Sherlock Holmes himself.
Elementary, my dear constable, elementary. Poor old fellow. He's got a bad cough. Lung condition, probably. Well, there doesn't seem to be anything much to discover. No possible way of scaling the front of the building from below. How about the roof? Could he have come across from another building?
No, sir. Inspector Lestrade looked at that first thing. Roof's all divided off with iron bars. Spikes on them. About as easy to break into as the Bank of England.
Well, may as well be getting on home. Yes, I dare say even Holmes couldn't solve this.
Here's look where you're going, you clumsy fool.
Oh, I say, I'm terribly sorry. I hope you're not hurt.
Who cares about me? It's my books that matter. Struck them right out of my hand. There they are, lying all over the road. Mud on their covers.
Oh, please, let me pick them up.
No, you don't. And don't you touch them. You've done enough damage already. Mercy on us. Such a mess. Nobody appreciates good books nowadays.
Well, at least let me apologize. I'm
really go away, Dunna. Don't bother me. Can't you see I'm busy? Go home, can't you? You're new use standing around here.
Well, maybe he's right. Good night, Constable.
Good night, Doctor.
The Straw knows where to find me in case he wants me. Any calls while I was out, Rosie?
No, sir.
Oh, good. Maybe my luck is in tonight. It was about time I had a peaceful evening at home. Oh, I spoke too soon. See what it is this time, Rosie. Croup or measles.
Yes, sir, right away.
No more privacy than a Siamese twin. Doctor can't call his soul his own. And as for ever get... Oh, yes, Rosie, who is it and what does he think he has?
It ain't a patient, sir.
No? What then?
I don't rightly know, sir. He's an old fellow with white whiskers, like a billy goat. Said to tell you it was your bibliophile calling.
My what? Who the bibliophile?
You're surprised to see me so soon, eh?
Well, how do you do? Come in.
Thank you.
That's all, Rosie.
Oh, yes, sir.
Well, please sit down. I hope you're recovered from the bump I gave you.
Well, that's what I came to see you about, Dr. Watson.
Oh, yes?
I've got a conscience, sir, and when I chanced to see you come into this house, I came hobbling after you, because I said to myself, I'll just step in and see that kind gentleman and tell him I'm sorry I was a bit gruff a while back, and no harm meant. And I'm much obliged for offering to pick up my books.
Oh, not at all.
Maybe you collect books yourself.
Well, no, I can't say that I do.
And never too late to learn. Now, here's a copy of British Birds, and here's a very fine Catullus.
Yes, but...
Or perhaps this Holy War would be more in your line.
Well, really, you know, I don't think...
A bargain, every one of them. With 5 volumes, you could just fill that gap on the second shelf.
So untidy, my dear Watson, quite unlike your old self.
Huh. Holmes!
Obviously. I wondered how long it would take you to penetrate my disguise.
You're not dead.
Your reasoning, my dear Watson, as usual, is faultless.
For heaven's sake,
easy, Watson, easy.
My dear Holmes, I think I sit down.
It's a very good idea. I'd better have a nip of this brandy.
Yes, I do with a bracer.
My dear Watson, 1,000 apologies. I had no idea you'd be so affected.
Well, I am not made of chilled steel like you, Holmes. Where's my pendant?
Here you are.
That's better. So it's really you standing here in my study. Well, thank heaven, why, you old reprobate, you. How in heaven's name did you ever come back alive out of that dreadful chasm where Professor Moriarty met his death?
It's quite simple. I was never there.
Yes, but good heavens, Holmes, it's been 3 years. You let us believe you were dead all that time. Now, was that nice, I ask
not,
you?
Not nice, Watson, but necessary. You see, Moriarty's gang was still to be dealt with. I was much safer if they believed I'd met my death at the same time as their illustrious leader. For 3 years, I've been living in disguise, tracking the members of that foul brotherhood to the ends of the earth. And now I'm happy to say there's only one left to be dealt with.
But look here, Holmes, why didn't you let me know who you were when I bumped into you in Park Lane just now?
Because, my dear Watson, you were being watched by the man I'm after. The last of Moriarty's gang.
Good heavens, who is he?
Someone you doubtless know, Watson. You may have even played whist with him on numerous occasions. And lost. Most people lose when they play with the tiger, as Moriarty used to call him. A clever man, Watson. Very clever. He not only suspects that I'm alive, he even guesses I've returned to London.
Good Lord.
Yes, but I mean to take advantage of this cleverness. I've set a trap for him. I expect to catch my tiger tonight.
Tonight?
Exactly. I don't suppose you'd care to come along.
You just try to prevent me, that's all I have to say. Just wait till I get my hat and stick.
I think you'll find your old army revolver a little more appropriate, Watson.
And now, while Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson start tracking one of London's master criminals, suppose we tell you how to track down one of the most satisfactory bargains in the clothing business. Clippercraft concentrates on delivering exactly what you want in your clothes at remarkably low prices for such fine quality. You want long wear? Well, examine the rich, staunchly woven Clippercraft fabrics. You want comfort? You get it in Clippercraft through the most skillful designing experience can bring you. And you want the smartness your friends will admire? Clippercraft brings you all three. Smart styling, long wear, solid comfort, at unbelievably modest prices. It's the result of the unique Clippercraft plan, concentrating the buying power of 1036 of the nation's finest stores from coast to coast, and bringing you amazingly fine suits at only $40 and $45, top coats in fine coverts and worsted gabardine for only $40 and $45, sport jackets for only $26.50, and smart tropicals at only $33.75 to $40. Yes, selling expensive clothes at inexpensive low prices at the nation's finest stores is the great big idea behind the Clippercraft plan. That's why men who know insist on Clippercraft clothes. So be sure to visit the Clippercraft store in your city.
These leading stores in the metropolitan area are proud to add their names to Clippercraft in your suits, top coats, and sport jackets and tropicals. In Manhattan, John Wanamaker Men's Stores, Broadway at 8th and 67 Liberty Street. Saks 34th, Broadway at 34th. In Brooklyn, Abraham and Strauss. In Newark, New Jersey, Boulevard Men's Shop, Kresge Newark. And in Jamaica, the B&B Clothes Shop, 16408 Jamaica Avenue.
Now back to Holmes and Watson. We find them slinking down a dark and sinister little alleyway.
I say, Holmes, do we have to do all this pussyfooting down dark mews and through smelly stables?
Absolutely, my dear Watson. It's essential that we should not be followed at this stage of the game. Yes, we've passed Manchester Street and Blandford Street. Here, down this narrow passage.
Good Lord. It's as dark as the black hole of Calcutta.
Here, scale this fence.
Scale the fence?
Now, don't tell me you've let yourself get out of condition during my absence.
Certainly not, only... Do you think it's quite dignified?
Probably not, but who'll ever know? Up with you.
Well, all right. I've ruined the knees of my trousers.
Oh, stop burbling, Watson, and come along. We've got to get into this house.
Yes, but look here. It's an empty house.
Quite. That's why I selected it. Now, where did I put that key?
Don't tell me you're not going to pick the lock. Holmes, you're losing your grip.
Quiet. Come in. Easy does it. Shut the door after you. Gently, my dear Watson.
Gently. Well, I'm doing my best. It was a draft. Well, now what?
Come along upstairs. We should get a good view from the windows of the upper front room.
You know, Holmes, there's something spooky about an empty house. Strange noises, boards squeaking.
Easy. We turn a corner here.
Are you with me?
Oh, absolutely.
Ah, this is the room. Excellent. The light from the street lamps, all the illumination we shall need.
Look here, Holmes. There's something familiar about this street out there. Why, of course, it's Baker Street.
Exactly. We're in Camden House, which stands opposite our old quarters.
Jove, no wonder it looked familiar. But why station ourselves here?
Because it commands an excellent view of our historic dwelling. Might I trouble you, my dear Watson, to draw a little nearer to the window, taking every precaution not to show yourself.
Right.
And then look up at our old rooms. We'll see if 3 years of absence have entirely taken away my power to surprise you.
Well, the windows of our sitting room are lighted. I see there's a man sitting in front of one. Well, look here, it's you. That is, at least it's your silhouette.
It's a bust of me, to be exact. Anything else of interest in Baker Street?
There's two disreputable-looking fellows leaning against a lamppost.
Excellent, Watson. I expected them.
Holmes, good heavens, your head. I mean the dummy. It moved.
Of course, our old friend Mrs. Hudson has orders to move it from below from time to time. Listen, what was that?
Sounded like a door closing.
Yes. I felt a draft. By all that's holy, he's going to operate from inside this building. I expected he'd work from the street as he did before. Quick, Watson, we've got to get out of here. You'll probably want this window.
You mean whoever we're after, he's coming in here?
Of course. Quick, Watson, into the next room. Here. Stand in the shadow where we can watch him without being seen.
I hear footsteps. He's coming.
Quiet, if you value your life.
Standing in the doorway. His face is in the shadow of his hat. Great Scott, his eyes blaze in the dark like a cat's.
Like a tiger's, Watson.
He's crossing to the window. He's raising the window.
Not very far, Watson. That won't be necessary.
His stick. His walking stick. Where is he pointing it out of the window?
It's a gun, Watson. Devilish invention. Doesn't make a sound. He's going to take a shot at my silhouette. When we hear the window across the street crash, we know he's fired.
He's aiming.
Get him, Watson! Get him! Get him!
Move, you are...
The gun, Watson! Put your hand behind him! Well, not before I squeeze the life out of you! Oh, no, you don't!
Watson. Watson, are you all right? I knocked him out.
Absolutely. What's that for?
Those two men from Scotland Yard down in the street leaning against the lamppost. I must say I thought our friend here would do his dirty work outside so they could deal with him firsthand. Ah, here come the regulars. Well, well, if it isn't Lestrade.
You bet it is. It took the job myself. And maybe we weren't glad to get your message at Scotland Yard half an hour ago. Although I must say we've done pretty well down there in your absence.
Really? Solved the Ronald Adair mystery yet?
Oh, well, that is...
Our sleeping beauty seems to be coming too. Gentlemen, allow me to present Colonel Sebastian Moran, late of Her Majesty's Indian Army. I believe I'm correct, Colonel, in saying that your bag of tigers still remains unrivaled.
You'll go to blazes.
Yes, a remarkable shot. You and your air gun were invaluable to the late Professor Moriarty, eh?
I might have known that wasn't you in the window.
Quite. I'm surprised that such a simple stratagem could deceive so old a shikar.
What do you mean by that?
How often, Colonel, have you tethered a goat to a tree, lain above it with your rifle, and waited for the bait to attract your tiger? This empty house is my tree. You are my tiger. The only difference being that I did not care to be the goat myself. Take him away, Lestrade.
Just a moment. You can't arrest me for taking a shot at a dummy, not even if it's the dummy of Sherlock Holmes.
That's quite right. I arrest you for the murder of the Honorable Ronald Adair, because you are the only man alive capable of shooting a man through the slightly opened window from the street below without being heard. A truly remarkable shot, Colonel. A bit too remarkable. That's how I knew you were the murderer.
Now come along, you. Frank, bring that stick along.
Right, sir.
We'll need it as evidence.
Well, Watson, what do you say? Shall we step across the street to our old quarters?
Right, ho.
I think you'll find everything just as it used to be. And I'm sure Mrs. Hudson is anxiously awaiting us with sandwiches and a steaming pot of coffee.
Ah.
You see, I remember your weakness.
My weakness? Well, I like that. And that, Mr. Harris, is the story of how I went to live in Baker Street again and started another series of incredible and amazing adventures, which I shall tell you about, if it won't bore you.
Well, what do you think, Dr. Watson? You know, there's just one thing I don't understand about tonight's story, though. Why did Colonel Moran kill Ronald Adair?
Because Adair had discovered Moran was cheating at cards and threatened to expose him. You remember that I said Adair had won £400 at whist the week before with Moran as his partner.
Yes.
That amount made Adair suspicious. He discovered the cards were marked. The very cards, by the way, which were found beside the dead body. He was examining them again to be sure he'd made no mistake. That's why the door was locked on the inside. He didn't want anyone to interrupt him.
I see. Well, what about next week's story, Dr. Watson?
Let me think. Next week, suppose I tell you about a rather curious dinner that Holmes and I attended in order to see if we could discover if a world-famous violinist was trying to poison his wife.
Did you succeed?
In a way, yes. Of course, there was a death, but I'll tell you all about it next week.
The makers of Clipper Craft Clothes and 1036 leading stores from coast to coast have brought you another in the new series of broadcasts featuring the world's most famous detective, Sherlock Holmes. Our stories are based upon the character of Sherlock Holmes, created by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Sherlock Holmes is played by John Stanley, Dr. Watson by Alfred Shirley, and the dramatizations are by Edith Meiser. Sherlock Holmes is produced and directed by Basil Lochran, with special music by Albert Berman. If you don't know your Clippercraft dealer, write Clippercraft, 200 Fifth Avenue, New York City. Be sure to listen next Sunday to Sherlock Holmes in The Case of the Very Best Butter. Cy Harris speaking for Clipper Craft Clothes. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
Radio England, UK1111.
The first equestrian to ride side saddle was Anne of Bohemia, daughter of the German Emperor Charles IV. She was born with one leg shorter than the other and was unable to ride a horse in the normal fashion. A special saddle was designed for her so that she could ride with both legs on the same side. Her vanity kept her from revealing the secret of her deformed legs, so that the saddle was termed a fashion innovation rather than a horse-mounted wheelchair. Believe it or not.
Sunrise and sunset, promise and fulfillment, birth and death. The whole drama of life is written in the sands of time.
we present a new series of radio programs, The Clock.
Nice to see you again. Pleasant to be back. Got a little time to spare? 30 minutes, maybe, by the clock? Funny thing about time. To some, it's priceless. To others, it has no value. It's the most perishable commodity in the world, and yet, it lasts forever. If we lose it, we're unhappy, but we don't mind giving it away. For instance, there was young Joey. Have you ever heard of Joey Harper? Well, perhaps you haven't. He's a likable young fellow, though. Alert, ambitious, and cheerful. Well, usually cheerful, anyway. For even the best of dispositions can often change. I'd like to tell you about Joey. Will you listen? It might be worth your while. It's so amazing you may not believe it, although it could have happened to you.
Oh, listen, Lois, listen. You gotta listen. It wasn't my fault. Oh, gee, honey. I love you. I wouldn't hurt you, Lois, for all the money in the world.
All the money in the world. Joey used those words before, but in a different way. Joey felt the money made the clock go round, and that everyone had it but him.
Joey?
Yeah?
What are you thinking about?
Your old lady.
What?
I mean your mother.
Oh. Gee, I'm sorry about what she said, Joey.
It's not your fault. Maybe I'll never have any more dough than I got right now. Maybe she's right, I'm just a bust.
Oh, don't say that, Joey. You gotta give yourself a little time.
Time? How much time do you think I got? I'm 22, Lois, practically middle-aged. I'll be tripping over my beard before I get a nickel in the bank.
Maybe it's your job, Joey.
No, it's not my job, Lois. I've done everything from selling insurance to driving a hack. But I always make the same amount, $35 a week.
You can't expect to be successful overnight.
Other guys can do it. Why can't I? You know, it's like a jinx. I work like a dog. I yelp for rays. I stick my nose to the grindstone till it hurts. But it always comes out the exact same way, Lois. 35 smackers a week.
Everybody can't be rich, I guess. Everybody can't have $1 million.
I wish I was so rich that $1 million was just like chicken feed. I wish I had all the money in the world.
Joey?
Yeah?
Look at this window display. Oh, isn't that a lovely ring?
I'll say it is.
Which one are you looking at?
The one with all those diamonds.
Well, that's not the one I mean, silly. I'm talking about the gold one. The plain one over there. The wedding ring.
Oh.
I guess it isn't really very expensive, is it?
Well, who cares? We're not going to buy it.
Joey!
Oh, let's face it, Lois. You know your mother won't let you get married to me. She thinks I'm a lemon. She wants to settle her with cash.
We just have to be patient.
Barry Cannon's the guy for her. His old man's got dough. He'll own the business one of these days, and he'll be in solid. Me? I'm just a jerk.
Joey, please don't spoil the evening by talking that way.
Barry's the perfect son-in-law. He's got dough in his pocket and a new suit in his back. Even the fillings in his teeth are made of gold. And someday I'm going to knock them out one by one just to prove my point.
Joey, if you dare get into a fist fight with Barry Cannon, I... Why, there he is. That's Barry in that car.
Hi there, sweetie.
Hello, Barry.
How goes it, Joe?
Pretty good. How'll you got here?
How do you like the bus?
Why, it's new, Barry.
Yeah, it's to be back 1500. Well, it's got style.
Oh, I think it's lovely. Don't you, Joey?
It reminds me of a hearse.
Joey!
Still sore at the world, Joey?
Why don't you take that overpolished kitty car and go right home?
Joey, I wish you wouldn't be so rude.
Oh, that's all right, Lois. I don't bruise easily. You come to my party on Friday night?
Well...
We're dressing, you know. It's formal.
Well, we're not going, Barry.
Well, if you're worried about the clothes, I can lend you my dinner jacket. I'm wearing tails.
You'd certainly look good with tails, Barry. Hanging from a tree.
Joey!
All right. If this guy appeals to you so much, Lois, I'll bow out. I'm sick and tired of hearing him talk about himself. And I'm sick and tired of hearing your family talk about me.
Hey, what is this? Lover's quarrel?
Barry, you driving uptown?
Sure.
Would you drop me at my home?
Hop in.
When you're ready to apologize, Joey Harper, you can let me know.
Joey just stood there and watched Lois drive away. And he felt she didn't understand. The tragedies of youth can be painful things, mellowed only by time alone. If he could only have explained to Lois. If he could have only told her...
You don't know what it means, Lois, when a guy can't afford to buy his girl an engagement ring. When I take you to the movies, we always sit in the cheapest seats. After a while, Lois, it gets so you begin to think that money's the most important thing on earth. And you can't live without it. Sometimes you even feel you don't want to live without it.
Yes, if Joey could have told her that, the story might have been different. But he didn't. He had too much pride. So he merely watched the girl he loved drive away with another boy. Then he turned and walked slowly home. But every once in a while, he'd pause in front of a shop window and look hungrily inside.
Beautiful, aren't they?
What?
Those ermine wraps.
Huh. Oh, yeah, cost a lot of dough.
In the next shop, they have a cigarette case. Made of solid gold.
You know, it'd take me a week to make enough money to even buy the boxes they come in.
That money won't bring you happiness.
That line was invented for laugh by the guys who got it.
Really?
And the laugh is on guys like me.
You're wrong, my boy.
Who says so? Who are you, anyway?
I beg your pardon. I didn't mean to intrude.
He was a little old man in a worn felt hat. And to Joey, he seemed as old as... well, time. He seemed to shuffle as he walked, as if his balance was bad, and Joey saw him start to cross the street. The light suddenly changed, and the heavy surge of traffic made the old man panicky. He started to run without looking around. And the driver in the bus turned the corner and didn't see him. And then Joey Harper bounded forward and made a flying dive. The two of them rolled over to the curb.
What happened?
You almost got killed, that's what. Here. Let me help you up.
Thank you. That bus, I didn't see that bus.
Look, mister. In New York, you watch where you go when you cross the street. Those 10-ton buses can make a permanent crease in your future.
Yes, I guess I'm not used to all this traffic, but... you saved my life, young man.
Forget it.
No, young man, you saved my life. Not that it's worth very much to me. But I have a great capacity for gratitude.
Well, I guess you and I are in the same boat, Pop, when you say your life isn't worth very much.
But I'm old, and I have no one who cares. But you're young and strong. Why do you feel the way you do?
It's simple, Pop. I'm broke.
You mean, haven't got a job?
Well, I got a job. I can always get a job, but what good does it do? I'll never make enough to live the way I like.
How would you like to live?
You ever read The Count of Monte Cristo?
Yeah.
Well, that's the kind of dough I'd like to have. Not $1,000 or even a million. I'd like to have so much money there'd be no end to it. I'd like to wrap up the world in cellophane and stick it in my pocket like a pack of cigarettes.
Yes, but money isn't everything.
It's enough for me.
You see, I have the kind of money that you talk about. Unlimited quantities to do with as I please. I am the richest man who ever lived. But it doesn't make me happy.
Pop, you didn't crack your head on that curb, did you? You feel okay?
Where do you live, young man?
87 Nettle Street. Why?
And what's your name?
Joey Harper.
My name is Pickering, and I'm going to reward you for saving my life.
You better keep your money, mister. You look like you need as much as me.
I said I'm going to reward you, Joey. And I mean it.
Yeah?
I'm going to give you all the money in the world.
Joey watched the old gentleman shuffle away, and in spite of his depression, Joey smiled. All the money in the world. Joey doubted if the old man had anything more valuable to give away than... his time. But Joey didn't know how valuable the old man's time could be. A few minutes later, Joey reached his furnished room. He made a big decision. He was going away for good. He'd forgotten all about Mr. Pickering by the time he'd packed his bag, but when he opened the door to go, the old man was standing there with an envelope in his hand.
Good evening.
Oh, hello, Mr. Pickering.
Are you going somewhere?
I'm getting out of this town.
For keeps, I'm through bucking the system. I know when I'm licked.
Do you have a minute to spare?
Sure. Come in.
Thanks. So this is where you live.
Yeah, classy, isn't it?
Do you prefer more elaborate quarters?
And I'm going to get it, too. Tomorrow night I'll probably sleep in the park, and then I'll have plenty of room to move around.
Well, I'd suggest a four-story brownstone mansion. I believe there's one available right now. Of course, you'd have to arrange for a staff of servants, but that could be managed, too.
What are you trying to do? Give me a ride?
You can give it to me, Joey, when you get your limousine.
Well, right now I'm using the stuff.
Joey! Come back, Joey.
Would you mind leaving me alone?
Come back, Joey. And open this envelope. It may change your mind about many things.
What's in that envelope?
When you open it, you'll see. But before you do, remember this is only a trickle. It's a drop in the bucket. There's more where that came from, lots more, and I promise you I'll keep you well supplied.
You must be nuts.
I have no more use for what you'll find in that envelope, Julie. I've achieved my goal, you see. I only hope it'll help you to achieve your own. Good. Open it, Julie.
Hey, it's money.
$500,000 in $1,000 bills. It's yours, Joey. It's all yours.
Have you ever wished upon a star and had that wish fulfilled? It's common among mortal men. Joey knew the meaning of wish fulfillment when he stared at all the money on that table. For 5 full minutes, and I timed him personally, he didn't move. $500,000. And Mr. Pickering had said it was only a drop in the bucket.
What are you thinking of, Joey?
I...
Are you planning to do a lot with your money, or are you thinking of calling the police?
I just can't talk.
No, Joey, I didn't rob a bank or lift a payroll.
Then where'd you get the money?
Are you asking questions, Joey? Are you going to waste time in quibbling, or are you going out to satisfy every dream and every ambition you've ever had?
You're right, Mr. Pickering. I'm just a sap. I didn't tear him a hair and beat him a chest and pray for a break, and then when I get one, I'm scared.
Scared? What's there to be frightened about? You didn't steal anything. There's everything you've ever wanted on that table, and there's more to come. So why bother with questions? Grab it, Joey. Stuff it in your pockets. Go out and spend it.
You just watch my theme.
There's a store downtown, Joey. An expensive establishment that deals in boats. They have a yacht in the sales.
And that's the first on the list. I'll stop with the expensive stuff and then work my way down the scale of the junk. Oh, where's my hat? Oh, never mind. I'll buy a couple of dozen on my way down.
Help you.
That's a nice pub you got down there, mister.
Yes, it is, isn't it?
And what's it cost?
Well, that yacht is our largest model, 90 feet, accommodates 14 people. Its cabins are completely furnished. It requires a crew of 6.
I ask what it cost.
$145,000. F-O-B.
I'll take it.
You what?
I said I'll take it.
And how will you pay for it?
In cash. $145,000, any tax?
You've got that cash in your pocket.
$145,000 on the nose. No tax?
The tax is included, sir.
Have it shipped to the Hudson River and let me know what pier. I'll give you my address and you just give me a receipt. And if you're a nice boy, I'll come around and buy another one. When the paint wears off the one I got.
You've heard of King Midas? Well, he was a candidate for the poorhouse compared with Joey Harper. You wouldn't believe what he managed to accomplish in the next 3 hours. You wouldn't believe it unless I gave you my word for it, and I was there with him when it happened.
116-cylinder limousine, I'll pay for it in cash.
Yes, sir.
One ermine wrapped from a gold brand, and I'll pay for it in cash.
Yes, sir.
This Delco looks nice. I'll take 4, and don't forget the shoes, the shirts, the socks, and the suits. I want the most expensive money can buy. Oh, yeah, and throw in those garters over there. You know, the ones with the diamond buckles? And stick my initials on everything, brother, just the way I like. If you got something to sell, then bring it up. I'll buy anything and everything just as long as it isn't cheap, and I'll pay for it in cash.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, Joey.
Mr. Pickering.
I hope you don't mind my waiting here in your room. I was wondering how you made out.
Oh, I'm doing fine. I just bought that four-story private house. You know, the one that faces Fifth Avenue? And I told her to throw in the doorman for luck.
How does it feel to have all that money?
Oh, it feels like being on a merry-go-round.
You haven't got tired of it yet?
Tired of it? You mean there are people who get tired of money?
I was merely asking.
Brother, I'll never get tired of it.
Well, enjoy yourself, Joey. I presume you have everything you want.
Just about, except my girl. But when her mother hears about this doll... Oh, yeah, but that reminds me, I'm running short.
I thought you might.
I don't like to be a hog about this, Mr. Pickering, but you told me it was only a drop in the bucket.
Quite so.
And half a million isn't nearly enough for what I want to buy.
I guessed as much, so I took the liberty of bringing more.
You mean... inside the suitcase?
Yes, Joey. There's $10 million in here.
$10 million?
Do you think it might last for the rest of the week? However, it doesn't matter. There's really no limit to what you can spend. Oh, Joey, the money is mostly in $1,000 bills.
So I noticed.
And just in case you've been having trouble changing bills of that denomination, I've added a few $100,000 in fives and tens. I hope you don't mind.
$10 million. Holy smokes.
Enjoy it, Joey. And remember that the bucket hasn't even been touched.
What a boat, Joey. And what a car. That's the slickest job I ever saw.
Now come around on Sunday, Barry, and I'll have my chauffeur take you for a spin around the park.
Oh, Joey, darling, I think it's wonderful. Mother just can't wait until we get married.
Well, she'll just have to wait. Tell her to take it easy, and maybe I'll even invite her to the wedding.
Two Rembrandts and one Da Vinci. Is there anything else you'd like to buy, sir?
Why, sure. There must be something else. There must be.
Yes, Joey had bought everything he could think of, and he still had millions left. He had all the money in the world, but he didn't have all the time in the world in which to spend it. Then something peculiar started to happen in Joey's mind. The last shopping spree he'd had wasn't half as much fun as the first. There didn't seem to be anything left for him to buy. He had everything a man could ask for, yet somehow he wasn't happy. And he wondered why.
Joey.
Oh, hello, Mr. Pickering.
I thought I'd come up and see you again, once more.
Oh, now, look, Mr. Pickering, I don't need any more money. Honest, I don't. Look, I'm having a tough enough time right now spending what you gave me, so will you take it easy for a while, please?
What's the matter, Joey? You sound unhappy. You have everything you want, everything you've ever wished for. Isn't that enough?
Well, it should be.
But it isn't. I know. I came to that conclusion myself. You see, Joey, you have nothing to look forward to, nothing to work for. When things come as easily as they've come to you, they lose their value. They become cheap, Joey, even though they're worth a fortune.
Is that what happened to you, Mr. Pickering?
My fate was even worse. All my life, I lived to achieve one goal. And then, when I thought I'd accomplished an artistic triumph, I found that I'd failed. But one day I'll try again, Joey. Oh, yes, one day I'll try again.
Try what?
To make the perfect $1,000 bill.
You made that money you gave me yourself?
I am a printer, Joey, and for 20 years I've printed nothing but handbills and dinner menus. But I also happened to be a genius, and I was going to prove it. My goal was to make money so perfect in every detail that the right thing would look like a counterfeit.
Oh, you didn't think of it, though. You didn't.
Now, just a minute, Joey. No. Remember this. I didn't make that money to cheat the government. Oh, no. I never spent a cent of it. To me, it was an artistic goal. No more, no less. I am not a counterfeiter, Joey. I am an artist. Here, Joey, what are you doing?
I'm calling the police.
Don't bother. They're right outside your door. They followed me here.
You got me into this, Mr. Pickering. You got me into this. You got to get me out.
Joey, you're getting too excited.
I didn't know that though was bad. You gave it to me. You told me it was a reward, Mr.
Pickering. And so it was a generous reward.
Open up in the name of the law.
No,
Nolly, I'm going to take me. Stay out. Stay out of
you
here.
You can't escape, Julie. There's nothing you can do. And your time is running short.
You and your money. Why'd you keep out of my life? Who wants your money? Who wants it? Who wants it?
There's your man, officer. Do your duty.
Why, it's the district attorney himself.
$5 million. He passed $5 million in counterfeit money.
And we'll give him a year in jail for every nickel.
No, no,
oh, he
no.
told me his chauffeur would take me for a ride. Huh. Now he'll take a little ride for himself.
Keep away from me. Keep away from me, all of you.
My mother was right. Joey Harvey, you've disgraced me.
Lois, Lois, you gotta listen, Lois. I wouldn't hurt you, Lois. Lois, honest, I wouldn't.
500 years in jail.
In solitary confinement.
And I get the girl.
No.
500 years in jail.
And hard labor.
And I get the girl.
Oh, no, don't touch me, Lois, Lois. You've got to live.
Lois, listen. Lois, my fault. You've got to listen, Lois.
It's all right, Joey. I know. We all know, Joey. But, Joey, it's all right. What? Joey. Joey, darling.
Lois? Where are we?
You're in a hospital, Joey. You've been delirious ever since you started to come out of the ether.
Ether?
Don't you remember? That old man you tried to save downtown, you pushed him out of the way and the bus hit you.
The bus hit me?
But the doctor said you'd be all right. Oh, Joey, I was so frightened, so scared I'd lose you.
Then it was all in my mind. Just in my mind.
You talked so much and said such funny things. The doctor told me that often happens to patients like you. Joey?
Well?
Haven't you noticed the flowers?
Oh, yeah. The flowers.
Mother sent them.
What?
Joey, you're a hero. You've saved somebody's life. You're going to be in the papers tomorrow and everything. But best of all, Mother thinks you're wonderful. And she's planning the wedding just as soon as you're well. Oh, I don't care if we have to struggle a while, because I know you'll make good if we work hard together.
Mr. Pickering said you gotta have something to look forward to and work for to be happy.
Mr. Pickering? Well, who's he?
Just the guy I met out of the ether. Lois, pinch me.
Pinch you? What for?
I just want to make sure I'm still not under the ether.
And that's the story of Joey Harper as recorded by The Clock.
Well, it worked out pretty well, all things considered.
The moral?
Well, yes, I suppose there is a moral to this story, but I prefer to leave it up to you. Sleep on it tonight. Give me your answer in the morning. I'll be at your bedside, but I'll make sure to ring before I drop in. And now it's time to leave you once again. It's been very pleasant for me. I hope it's been enjoyable for you.
The Clock will be heard again next week, same time, same station. This program is written by Lawrence Klee, and you've heard Hart McGuire as The Clock, as Joey Rodney Jacobs, as Mr. Pickering, Owen Ainley. Others were Carly Neville, John Bonney, Ken Hannum. The Clock is directed by John Saul, a Grace Gibson radio production.
Radio England, UK1.
This is Classic Poetry Aloud. You can hear more readings of classic poetry at classicpoetryaloud.com. Songs from the Princess. Tears, Idle Tears by Alfred Lord Tennyson. Tears, idle tears, I know not what they mean. Tears from the depth of some divine despair rise in the heart and gather to the eyes in looking on the happy autumn fields and thinking of the days that are no more. Fresh as the first beam glittering on a sail that brings our friends up from the underworld, sad as the last which reddens over one that sinks with all we love below the verge, so sad, so fresh, the days that are no more. Ah, sad and strange as in dark summer dawns, the earliest pipe of half-awakened birds, dying ears, when unto dying eyes the casement slowly grows a glimmering square. So sad, so strange the days that are no more. Dear as remembered kisses after death, and sweet as those by hopeless fancy feigned on lips that are for others. Deep as love, deep as first love, and wild with all regret, O death in life, the day.
You know, when I go shopping now, and I'm not acting daft, you know, and I'm being serious, and I walk in, and I walked into the shoe shop, and I said, a pair of crocodile shoes, please. He said, certainly. What size is your crocodile, say?
Radio England, you say one.
This is Crime Classics. I am Thomas Highland. I'm going to tell you another true crime story. Listen. The man is nailing a horse's picture to the wall. The horse is pawing the western skies in the classic attitude of pawing horses, and it is the top half of a calendar distributed by Isaac's Livery. It's a hot April day in St. Joseph, Missouri, in the year 1882. And the man is hanging the picture in his living room because he has a fondness for the noble beast. Horses have gotten him out of many a critical situation, such as 1, holding up railroads, 2, robbing banks, 3, murdering fellows. His name is Jesse James. And as soon as he finishes hanging that picture, a friend of his is going to shoot the back of his head off. So tonight, my transcribed report to you on the death of a picture hanger. Crime Classics, a new series of true crime stories taken from the records and newspapers of every land, from every time. Your host each week, Mr. Thomas Highland, connoisseur of crime, student of violence, and teller of murders. Now, once again, Thomas Highland. We take you to Jefferson City, Missouri, to the mansion of the governor of that state. His name was Crittenden, but his cronies called him Critch. He liked living in the governor's mansion because he never had it so good. There were servants, crystal chandeliers, wine furnished by cronies, entertainments by cronies, and best of all, 6 small gilded cherubs, backs bent cheerfully to support a cast iron bathtub, and quite often the governor also. So, if you've never attended the governor taking a bath, here's your chance.
Where's that soap? Where is it?
Oh, there it is, Critch. Right behind you.
Sir.
Uh-huh.
When's the last time you had a bath?
Kansas City. Just after the hanging of Billy Bob Williams. Let's see, that was,
March 12th, last.
What a memory you got, Governor.
Yeah, hanging outlaws, one of the nicest parts of this job, General Lake. You ever get to be governor, hang a lot of outlaws and remember when. That way you can tell people and people will be impressed and keep you governor.
I'll remember.
Hand me that rose water and glycerin, Sheriff.
Oh, sure.
Oh, thanks. You know what I called you down here for?
Got an idea.
Tell me and I'll tell you if you're right.
Jesse James?
Look good on my record. He to die somehow soon. During my administration in my state.
People will cheer you wherever you go.
I like the sound of people cheering.
Governor.
Hand me the towel, sir. Thanks.
Governor, I've been thinking.
Scheming kind of thinking?
Well, you might say.
About Jesse?
If it works, people are liable to cheer you right on to Washington. Then there's no telling what.
In a case like that, you're liable to be standing right where I'm standing.
That's right.
Get Jesse for me.
I'm going to do that.
Not since Kansas City, huh, Sheriff?
Not since then.
Well, how'd you like to take a bath right now?
I didn't want to say nothing. I was hoping you'd ask.
She's all yours, Sheriff. Enjoy yourself.
Sheriff Timberlake was a man who instinctively knew his way around a bathtub. He soaked, lathered, and rinsed, and was out of there in the shape of a lamb's tail. Then he went home. Then he changed his clothes. He got into a nondescript outfit of brown woolen pants and a black alpaca coat. And he went down to Kansas City. Many things were to be found in Kansas City. A wooden monument, long since burned, of Daniel Sanker, who got a message through to his beleaguered dad, a grand opera house, and three mechanical pianos, each with fiddle attached. All in all, it was a very happy community. Worthy of note is the fact that Spit in the Ocean, a poker variation, was invented at Bobrick's Poker Palace during this era. And it is into this very den that Sheriff Timberlake wandered. He wandered here because he was looking for someone. A girl. A young lady whose job it was to stand in back of strangers at the gaming tables and make signals to the houseman on the opposite side. When Timberlake approached her, she had three fingers in the air and the tip of her tongue pointing to the left.
Maddie.
Oh.
Up to you, Hunter.
Want to talk with you, Maddie.
A second.
Raise you.
Carl.
Now get me a one-eyed jack in the hole. Gives me three of them. Where'd you say you're from? Roanoke?
Nice place. Come on. Out here. What you want?
How's Johnny?
You said you weren't going to turn him in.
For favors.
What you want him to do?
Nothing.
What you want?
Jesse James.
Oh.
Got to clean up Missouri, Matty.
Oh?
Got to start with Jesse.
If you say it.
Yeah, Jesse's staying with Robert and Charlie Ford.
That's right.
Now, your friends, ain't they, Matty, Robert and Charlie Ford?
I used to know them pretty good.
Ain't hard to talk to old friends, Matty.
And you ain't going to touch Johnny, are you?
You just tell Robert and Charlie Ford I'm in Stamponi's boarding house right now. I ain't got a gun, either.
That all you want me to do?
You tell them, Matty. Yeah? Open. Come on in, boys. Well, didn't Matty tell you I left my guns back in Jefferson City? Just you come on in.
Bob, over there.
All right. Glad to see you back in Missouri, Charlie. Heard you and Robert were over in Kansas for a while. Heard you're in jail. Heard you killed a man to get out. Glad to see you back in Missouri.
Bob, get him.
All right. I told you I weren't holding no iron, boys.
Making sure. Take your shirt off him, Bob. Now let him go, Bob. How come you ain't holding nothing, Sheriff?
Well, now you know what I'm going to say, you believe.
Call him back here, Bob. Where you was before.
All right.
Sheriff, you crazy?
Let me ask you a question, then you decide. How'd you like a full pardon for what you done in Missouri, Charlie? Robert, you need never go back into Kansas. You're free to stay here as long as you live. Come and go as you please. Don't have to worry about killing four people in Missouri. besides have $10,000. You've been robbing, you've been stealing, you've been killing. You got $10 between you? Both of you murderers, thieves, scum. I figured you'd do that. I'm glad you did. Because now you're hating yourself.
Put your gun back, Bob. Let him run on a little bit more.
You like Jesse James, Charlie?
Ain't nothing about him I like or don't like.
You like Jesse, Robert?
Man's talking to you, Rob. Wants to know you like Jesse. Do you? Once Jesse and Bob had a little fight. 2 years ago, Bob was only 19, and Jesse a full-grown man. When Jesse was finished with Bob, Bob got to be a full-grown man.
The governor wants Jesse dead or alive.
A lot of people do.
Governor says he'd give both of you a full pardon and $10,000 for Jesse.
Ain't no bargain, Jesse being who he is. Gunfighter like he is, and fast like...
Whatever, dude, it'd be a hero. People cheer.
That'd be nice.
What'd you say, Robert?
That'd be nice.
Ride with the governor.
That'd be nice.
Being a hero instead of a running dog.
I like that word.
Hero?
Yeah.
Robert?
Yeah?
Say it.
Hero.
What's the matter?
Listen to what I can say.
$10,000. Well, boys?
Jesse James died all of a sudden. Wouldn't take long for you to hear about it. We'd let you know.
That's a promise.
Governor in bathtub, sheriff in waiting, Matty the girl card watcher, and the brothers Ford, Robert, and Charlie. The principals involved in getting Jesse James assassinated. It would be well at this point to remark upon some of the accomplishments of Jesse James. His standard feat was murdering cowboys and rustling cattle. One incident in Starr County, Texas, had him murdering single-handedly three cowboys and driving off 500 fine head of beef. A record which stands to this day. On record, too, is his slaying by bowie knife of Mr. John W. Wicker, a Pinkerton man from Chicago. Then there were several train robberies, outstanding of which was the one 5 miles east of Council Bluffs, where he and his men derailed the Chicago, Rock Island, and Pacific Express. The cars telescoped. The engineer was instantly killed. 12 passengers were seriously injured. And Jesse and his men robbed them all. There are many other mayhems too numerous to mention, except that they averaged 1.37 corpses per exploit. One act of kindness must be noted, however. Mr. Avery Thompson, hurt grievously by a runaway horse in the streets of Abilene, pleaded to be put out of his misery. From 50 paces, Jesse obliged. His act of mercy was applauded by all around. It was, then, this half-kind, half-renegade person that the brothers Ford were going to kill. Charlie and Robert went home, lit the kerosene lamp, and waited. They didn't have to wait too long.
Jesse, come on in.
It was a Saturday night when Jesse walked through that doorway in Ray County, and Sunday was his favorite day because he could sleep late.
Thank you.
You are listening to Crime Classics and your host, Thomas Highland. Tomorrow night, if you're in the mood for still more adventure listening, don't miss 21st Precinct, the program that probes the inner workings of the world's largest police force. 21st Precinct shows you policemen as the human beings they are, exposes their tough grinds, their dangerous careers. Remember, it's Tuesday nights on most of these same stations, presented by CBS Radio. And now, once again, Thomas Highland and the second act of Crime Classics, and his report to you on The Death of a Picture Hanger. The night Jesse James walked into the Ford home, he was carrying a .45 Colt on one hip, .45 Smith Wesson on the other, and a .44 Derringer in his waistcoat, and a Winchester rifle hung limply from his left hand. Armed in this manner was standard operating procedure for Jesse when he walked into homes, a procedure which varied only some years before when he courted. At this time of romance, he did not wear the Derringer. It should be remarked, however, that the Winchester was kept by his feet like a faithful old dog. All of which adds up to the fact that all of the people who tried before this Saturday night to kill Jesse were long dead. And the Ford boys, Robert and Charlie, were well aware of this fact. But Robert wanted to be a hero, and Charlie wanted $10,000. So they were very hospitable.
Sit in the rocket, Jess. Want some whiskey? Bob. Heard you have been in Jefferson City, Jess.
Here you are, Jess. You must be sleepy, Jess.
What's the matter with you, Bob? You don't have to tell Jess when he's sleepy. Jess knows when he's sleepy.
I just want to talk important things to him, that's all. Not when his head's numb.
Simmer down, Bob.
All right, Jess, I'll tell you. We're tired of lazing around. Me and Charlie have been doing nothing, just waiting for you to say go. When are you going to say go, Jess?
Kid's anxious, Jess. Just like kids.
You're tired, that's all.
Been on my back like this for a week, Jess. Worrisome, ain't he?
Listen, Jess, we figured something.
The train, Jess. Trains are easy.
You hear what he said, Charlie? Trains are easy.
Kid.
The Chicago, Rock Island, and Pacific out of Kansas City. It makes a stop at Winston, Jess.
At Cameron, too.
It's a drink, Jess. We're going to do it to the train, Jess?
Yahoo! Need some sleep. Bob, fix Jess that place in the barn.
Sure will.
So Bob went out to the barn, fluffed up some straw, and made a bed for Jesse to sleep in. This was considered an act of compassion of the time. Barn owners to wayfarers. But in this instance, it was known as a tactic. Get Jesse on his back in the barn with maybe his guns off. Get him while he's sleeping. So consider now what we have here. Jesse James bedded down for the night and his two would-be assassins as guardian angels. In the trade, this is known as a precarious position. So switch now from prone Jesse to outside the barn. Nearly midnight in Missouri, and a mist from the river threading between Charlie Ford and Bob.
When are we going to kill Jess?
Try killing him from now on.
You think he's sleeping?
Where'd you bed him down?
Under that window.
Let's go peek, see if he's sleeping.
What you think?
He's lying there, all right.
Eyes closed.
Can't tell. Tell this,
What?
Look at that pool of moon. Wait a minute, I'll get out of your way. See?
He's holding a gun in each hand.
He's a light sleeper.
When he sleeps.
We don't even know he's sleeping.
Charlie. Shoot him. Get him.
You want to be the hero, younger brother. You do.
Supposing I miss.
I'll shoot you just where you're standing if you miss. Because if you miss, you exist. I'll just explain to Jess that I killed you and saved his life. That way, saving mine.
If we were sure he's sleeping, be no trouble at all.
You make sure.
If some kind of animal or something walked by him soft, that'd be a way. Hey, you wait here a minute. Come here, you little old dog. That's right. You're too old to live anyhow. Little dog's too old to live anyhow, Charlie. Step aside a minute. I'll push him through this chink in the wall. Critter'd run into the barn past Jess, and we'll find out for sure.
Well, shed her like a woman, Bob. Just do it. Bob and Charlie huddled together that night, and in the morning they flashed their nicest, sleepiest grins when they awoke to find Jesse James standing over them.
I shot me this critter last night. Who's going to cook me my breakfast?
The boys tumbled out of bed and vied who would be first at the skillet. Bob won, and Charlie put the kettle on. It was late, and it was Sunday, so they had brunch. Toward its end, as a gesture of carefree camaraderie, Jesse heaved the forge's best china against the wall.
Breaking them against the wall's easy, Jess. Why don't you throw them up in the air and shoot them?
Crazy, Bob. What'd you tell him to do that for?
Use up all his goods, and then we... Watch it, Jess!
Ain't gonna hit you, Bob. Just seeing how close I can come.
In the name of heaven, Jess!
Cut it out, Jesse. You got the kid almost crying.
Stand still. See how you like it, Charlie. See if I can fare in your ear without drawing blood. Now let's go do it to a train.
Which meant riding down to Winston, which meant for the Ford boys a constant vigilance for the moment when Jess would turn his back, would ride ahead of them a few paces, anything so that they could have an irretrievable advantage. Historians make category of this event as the ride to Winston with the Fords up front. Jesse just didn't trust anybody to ride in back of him, except his mom, but then she was only comfortable on very slow horses. So down to Winston they rode, and at 9:30 p.m. on Monday night, they boarded the Chicago, Rock Island, and Pacific train. As soon as the train started, they dressed themselves in white linen dusters. They wore red handkerchiefs over their faces, and they waited in the vestibule for the conductor. 15 minutes later, Jesse James and the Fords left behind them two corpses, a wounded engineer, and an empty duck cage, the boys having released a dozen ducks from the express car. They took with them $8,000 in cash and convertible mementos. The boys jumped off the train at a point where they had tethered their horses. Then they rode south. They rode to St. Joseph, Missouri. They rode to the home of Jesse James, with Jesse riding behind.
Wait out here, boys. Annie.
That you, Jess?
Sure.
I'm in the kitchen. Oh, hello, Jess.
Don't you kiss me now, Ann. You wait till I wash off this road dust.
I don't mind.
You're too pretty to get mussed up.
Oh, Jess.
What you got there, Ann?
I was in Isaac's today to see about some harness. He gave me this calendar. He said, you put this up in a nice place, Mrs. Howard.
Everybody in town calls you Mrs. Howard, don't they, Ann?
They call us the Happy Howards. They ask what you do. I say a traveling man. You been traveling, Jess?
I brought your watch, Mrs. Howard. Yeah.
Why, Mr. Howard, porcelain and gold, just what I wanted. Now you go away and wash so I can kiss you. What you doing to that calendar, Jess?
Pretty picture of a horse, Ann. Tear off the calendar part and look nice in the parlor. Nail it up in the parlor, Ann.
Some tacks and a hammer in the cabinet.
Brought the Ford boys with me, Ann.
Oh, that's nice. Mm-hmm.
I'll have the boys come in. You make us something to eat.
I'll fetch you some water first for horses.
Come on in, boys. You boys like this picture?
Right, good picture of a horse.
What are you going to do with it, Jeff? Figure to hang it here somewheres.
I wouldn't want me a picture of no horse in the parlor.
You just ain't got no eye.
No, he ain't. Yeah, you know, I think hanging a picture like that's real good. Where are you going to hang it, Jeff?
Here, I guess.
That's too low to hang a picture.
Yeah.
Higher. I had me that picture, and I was going to hang it. I'd hang it high.
Maybe you're right. Pleasant to be home.
How's your missus?
Pleasant to be home. Man don't have to carry around all these guns weighing heavy around his middle. Feels mighty fine.
I said, how's your missus, Jess?
Getting water. Gonna cook us something. Get off that chair, Bob.
What for?
You stupid. I said I was gonna hang me this picture.
All right.
Pretty picture.
Charlie!
He shot the back of Jesse's head off, Bob.
That make me a hero, don't it?
Sure does.
Shooting Mr. Howard, alias Jesse James, in the back was a very heroic deed. So heroic that a song was written about it. The refrain goes, "And the dirty little coward, he shot Mr. Howard and laid Jesse James in his grave." In just a moment, Thomas Highland will tell you about next week's crime classic. The Death of a Picture Hanger, tonight's crime classic, was adapted from the original court reports and newspaper accounts by Morton Fine and David Friedkin. The music was composed and conducted by Bernard Herrmann, and the program is transcribed and directed by Elliot Lewis. Thomas Highland is portrayed on radio by Lou Merrill. In tonight's story, Clayton Post was heard as Jess, Paul Freeze as Charlie, and Sam Edwards as Bob. Featured in the cast were Joseph Kearns, Charlotte Lawrence, Paula Winslow, and Joseph Granby. Roy Rowan speaking. Now here again is Thomas Highland.
Next week, a bedroom in Baltimore, Maryland, in June 1871. Its occupant, William Scott Ketchum, Major General, United States Army, retired. My report to you will be on the final day of General Ketchum and how he died. Thank you. Good night.
Radio England, UK1111.
He lived to tell about it, how he inherited his own fortune. He was Felix Zeme, the noted French painter.
After earning a fortune as a painter of Venetian landscapes, Zeme retired to such utter obscurity he was presumed dead. Just before his fortune was to pass to his relatives, he reappeared. But because the red tape of proving himself alive was so vast, he rewrote his own will, leaving his fortune to himself, believe it or not. A bed has been kept ready for the arrival of a guest for more than 1,400 years. A monk named Pao Chi died in the year 514 in the Memorial Temple of Hangzhou, China. His last words were, "I shall return." Apparently, Pao Chi's fellow monks took him at his word because they've changed the linen on Pao Chi's bed more than 57 million times over the last 14 centuries. Believe it or not.
Radio England, UK 11111.